Okay, sir. Best of luck. Thank you so much.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. I am Dr. Indranil Das, consultant pathologist, Oncology Laboratory, Kolkata. Today we are going to start our first lecture on genitourinary pathology. To start with, we will discuss the handling of adult kidney tumor specimen from tissue receiving to grossing of the specimen and microscopic examination. Only identification of the histopathological subtype is not sufficient for further management of the patient. Some associated parameters are also required to be mentioned in the further treatment and prognosis assessment. The anatomical structure of kidney has been depicted in this picture. Renal parenchyma is grossly divided into two regions, that is cortex and medulla. Outer to the cortex, there is renal capsule, which is covered by perinephric fat. And deep to renal medulla, there is renal pelvis containing renal sinus. From renal pelvis, ureter arises and goes downwards. All of us know that. What type of kidney tumor specimen do we receive in our day-to-day practice? Those are radical nephrectomy specimen with lymph node dissection, simple nephrectomy specimen, partial nephrectomy specimen, and two-cut needle biopsy specimen. Now, what are the differences between different types of specimen? The radical nephrectomy specimen consists of kidney with perinephric fat, gerotas fossa, a length of ureter, and with or without adrenal gland. Whereas in simple nephrectomy specimen, kidney with variable amount of perinephric fat and a length of ureter is removed. And the needle biopsy is done for preoperative diagnosis and introduction of neoadjuvant chemotherapy. As I mentioned, in the partial nephrectomy specimen, the entire tumor with a rim of normal kidney tissue has been excised, whereas in radical nephrectomy specimen, the entire kidney with perinephric fat and gerotas fossa and part of ureter has been resected. In specimen request form, the specimen laterality, type of operation, presence or absence of adrenal gland, any preoperative biopsy and histopathological study along with history of neoadjuvant chemotherapy should be clearly mentioned. Upon receiving a partial nephrectomy specimen, parenchymal or intrarenal surgical margin should be inked. You can or cannot ink the perinephric surface. After inking is complete, the specimen should be sliced perpendicular to the parenchymal surgical margin. In this radical nephrectomy specimen, a well-circumscribed yellowish tumor extending up to renal pelvis is noted near the upper pole. After receiving the specimen, the outer surface of the kidney should be inked. If incision is made prior to inking, retraction of renal capsule may occur. This may give a false positive impression of perinephric fat invasion. Midline longitudinal incision is preferred. It is given from lateral border of the specimen to the medial border. Alternatively, a probe can be inserted into the collecting system and the specimen can be opened via this channel. The macroscopic assessment of the tumor spread into perinephric fat or renal sinus tissue is important, as positive finding will upstage the tumor to PT3A. The specimen is cooked in the 10% nitrate buffered formalin with cotton placed in the resected frame. Keep it overnight. And the next day, in the grossing room, the specimen is oriented first. We all know that the ureter extends inferiorly from the hilum at the medial border, and at the hilum, renal vein and renal artery remains anterior to the ureter. Measurement, three-dimensional measurement of the entire specimen as well as that of the tumor is taken. Tumor is weighed. The length and caliber of the ureter as well as vessel are noted. We have to check whether there are presence of any thrombi in the renal vein and whether it is attached to the venous wall. If IVC is present, then it will form the venous margin. Hilar fat is examined to find out lymph nodes and check that renal gland. Notice its size. Check whether the tumor has directly invaded the tumor. It will give a PT4 stage, or whether a separate tumor nodule is present. Then it will be staged as M1. The macroscopic assessment of the tumor spread to the perinephric tract is important, as I said, and also whether the renal sinus contain tumor or not. It will assign a T3A stage. Now, what will happen if multiple tumors are present? Measure the maximum dimension of the largest 5 tumors. In excess of that, if any tumor shows different macroscopic appearance, then it should also be measured. Multiple tumors are usually found in syndromic associations. The syndromes are von Naples-Lindau syndrome, tuberous sclerosis, Bart-Hogg-Duke syndrome, hereditary leiomyomatosis and renal cell cancer associated RCC, and succinate dehydrogenase deficient RCC. Now, we have to take the sections. First, take sections from the vascular and ureteric cut margin. Then, sections should be taken from different areas of the tumor showing morphological dissimilarities. Tumor with necrotic area, tumor with perinephric fat interface, tumor with renal sinus interface, tumor with normal renal parenchyma interface, and adjacent tumor with adjacent renal pelvis and adrenal are to be sectioned. In case of multiple tumor, largest 5 should be sampled, and any smaller lesion with a different gross appearance should be sampled. Additional blocks can be taken from uninvolved renal parenchyma, any other incidental or satellite lesion, and all hilar lymph nodes. This is a schematic picture of area of sampling of radical nephrectomy specimen. Now, in partial nephrectomy specimen, section is taken from the tumor with suspected area of perinephric fat invasion, tumor with closest parenchymal margin, tumor with perinephric fat and uninvolved parenchyma, as distant as possible, preferably for more than 5 millimeter distance. From lymph node dissection specimen, all palpable lymph nodes should be blocked. The most important thing is whether the tumor is benign or malignant. The list of WHO classification of adult malignant epithelial neoplasm is quite big. Then the adult benign renal neoplasms are papillary adenoma, oncocytoma, metanephric adenoma, metanephric adenofibroma, metanephric stromal tumor, mixed epithelial and stromal tumor, and angiomyolipoma. But we will classify them into 3 groups for our morphological assessment. These are renal tumor with clear cell features, renal tumor with papillary features, and renal tumor with oncocytic features. Now, renal tumor with clear cell features. The entities included in this category is clear cell renal cell carcinoma, conventional type, multilocular cystic renal neoplasm of low malignant potential, clear cell papillary renal cell carcinoma, and TCB1 mutated renal cell carcinoma. Now, what are the renal tumors with papillary features? That is papillary renal cell carcinoma, that is type 1 and type 2, mucinous tubular and spindle cell carcinoma, collecting duct carcinoma, microphthalmia transcription factor family aberration associated RCCs, hereditary leiomyomatosis and renal cell carcinoma associated RCC, and metanephric adenoma. Now, these are the renal tumors with oncocytic features. The first one is oncocytoma, a benign tumor, then chromophobe renal cell carcinoma, and hybrid tumor composed of component of oncocytoma as well as homophobe RCC, and tuberocystic carcinoma, follicular thyroid-like carcinoma, this is a new entity, acquired cystic kidney disease associated RCC, rhabdoid renal cell carcinoma, this is not a different entity, basically a de-differentiated form of any sort of renal cell carcinoma, then epithelioid angiomyolipoma, this is a PECOMA, that means a perivascular epithelioid cell tumor, and unclassified RCC. Now, specific renal tumor classification may necessitate morphological suspicion, immunohistochemical workup, molecular testing, communication with urologist and or medical or radiation oncologist, that is CPC, clinico-pathological correlation, tumor or germline sequencing, and genetic counsel. Now, renal tumor with clear cell feature. The clear cell renal cell carcinoma is the most common malignant tumor of renal epithelial origin. It usually shows nest of clear cells surrounded by abundant intact fibrovascular septa. It usually presents in patients older than 40 years of age, and men are affected more frequently than the women. 1/3 of the patients develop metastasis during the course of disease. Some develop within 3 years of onset, and some may develop even after 10 years of onset of the primary disease. The most common site of metastasis are lung, liver, and bone. But virtually any site in the body can be affected. Grossly, the tumor appears as solid, lobulated, well-circumscribed golden yellow mass. Areas of necrosis and hemorrhage can be seen. Tumor with sarcomatoid transformation usually present as a fleshy tan mass. The tumor cells of RCC are cuboidal with centrally or basally located nuclei. The higher grade tumors show nuclear enlargement, prominent nucleoli, and multinucleation. The most reliable diagnostic feature is the presence of small caliber blood vessels surrounding the tumor nest. Areas of hemorrhage can be seen, as I mentioned. It has imparted an alveolar architecture. Other than alveolar architecture, microcystic, macrocystic, and pseudopapillary patterns can also be noted. 5% of the cases show sarcomatoid transformation that may resemble any high grade sarcoma. Now, immunohistochemistry. The diffuse pan membranous expression of carbonic anhydrase 9 can be seen. So, one diagnostic pitfall of carbonic anhydrase 9 is perinecrotic accentuation that may occur in any hybrid renal cell carcinoma. This is RCC with rhabdoid feature, the eccentrically placed hybrid nuclei with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm, and there is loss of BRCA-associated protein 1 in conventional RCC. The break apart phase for TFC marker gene will give a few signal. That is negative study in classical clear cell renal cell carcinoma. It would have been given a split signal in case of TFE3 mutated RCC that comes in the differential diagnosis of conventional clear cell renal cell carcinoma. Now, multilocular cystic renal neoplasm of low malignant potential. Grossly, the tumor entirely composed of cysts. Middle-aged adults are affected. The cysts are lined by single layer of cuboidal cells with abundant clear cytoplasm. Nuclei are of low grade, similar to ISUP or WHO grade 1 or 2 nuclei. Groups or clusters of clear cells with similar morphology are seen within the cyst wall. Necrosis, vascular invasion, and sarcomatoid transformation are incompatible with the diagnosis of multilocular cystic renal neoplasm of low malignant potential. Now, next entity is clear cell papillary renal cell carcinoma. Clear cell with low-grade apically oriented nuclei are present in this tumor. In contrast to conventional renal cell carcinoma, CK7 is diffusely positive and carbonic anhydrase 9 give a cap-like reaction pattern. The last entity in the clear cell subtype is transcription elongation factor B polypeptide 1 mutated RCC. It is another tumor with clear cell feature. It is a newly described entity. The TCEB1 mutated RCC show multilobular appearance due to presence of stromal band separating the tubulopapillary architectures containing clear cells. TCEB1 is a gene of von Naples-Lindau complex. And in this picture, you can see this carbonic anhydrase is positive in the cup-like fashion, and the nuclei are apically oriented. Now, the renal cell tumor with papillary features. The papillary renal cell carcinoma is the most common tumor with papillary architecture. They are divided into two categories, that is type 1 and type 2. Type 1 papillary renal cell carcinoma shows smaller cells with scanty to moderate amount of amphibolic cytoplasm, whether in type 2 papillary renal cell carcinoma, nuclear anaplasia, pseudostratification, and abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm can be seen. Foamy macrophages are present within the fibrovascular core, and pseudomonas are also seen. It is very important to exclude other entities from the differential diagnosis before rendering a diagnosis of PRCC type 2. These entities include TFEBP amplified RCC, hereditary leiomyomatosis, and renal cell carcinoma associated RCC and collecting that carcinoma. This is type 1 papillary renal cell carcinoma. The nuclei are of low grade and cytoplasm is eosinophilic, and the papillary lumen contains foamy histiocytes. And in type 2 papillary renal cell carcinoma, nuclei are much more pleomorphic, showing nucleomegaly, vesicular chromatin, and conspicuous nucleoma. On IHC, papillary renal cell carcinoma shows diffuse positivity for CK7 and MRCA. A subset of papillary type 1 papillary renal cell carcinoma show mutation in the MET proto-oncogene. A recently developed biomarker of type 2 PRCC is AKR1B10. Now, the papillary renal cell carcinoma have overlapping histological and immunohistochemical features with another tumor, that is mucinous tubular and spindle cell carcinoma. But this mucinous tubular and spindle cell carcinoma has a favorable diagnosis than the more favorable diagnosis than the papillary renal cell carcinoma type 2. This tumor is morphologically characterized by epitheloid cells in tubules and low-grade spindle cell pattern embedded in a myxoid or mucoid background. The PRCC with low-grade spindle cell foci may resemble low-grade spindle cell areas of MGSCC. The immunohistochemical profile is similar. This tumor also gives a positive reaction with CK7 and MRCA. This is MTSCC. Now, next entity is hereditary leiomyomatosis and renal cell cancer associated RCC. This tumor is caused by germline mutation in the fumarate hydratase gene. These patients show increased incidence of leioma. Previously, they were classified as type 2 PRCC. Microscopically, this tumor shows papillary architecture as mixed with other patterns, prominent nucleoli, and perinuclear clearing. Loss of fumarate hydratase expression on IHC is a very useful clinical aid for diagnosing this entity. Recently, diffuse positivity of 2-succinylcysteine immunostain has been demonstrated, but commercial kit is not routinely available. Now, microphthalmia transcription factor translocation RCC. Two well-described entity in this group are XP11 translocation carcinoma and translocation 6-11 carcinoma. The TFH3 gene is located on the short arm of X chromosome. Histologically, these tumors show papillary architecture lined by clear and eosinophilic plaque cells and presence of abundant seminal bodies. The XP11 translocation carcinoma does not express any epithelial marker, but TAX2 and TAX8 are expressed in 50% of the cases. This is renal tumor, XP11 translocation. The tumor cells are arranged in a papillary pattern with more eosinophilic cytoplasm and prominent melanin pigment. Now, translocation 6-11 carcinoma was initially considered to be a pediatric neoplasm, but adult cases are also seen. It is a biphasic tumor. Papilla formed by large epitheloid eosinophilic cells, and clusters of small eosinophilic cells with hyperchromatic nuclei are present. They are positive for cathepsin K, HMB45, and melanin E. Antibodies against TFEB are also positive. In this picture, we have shown all the tumors coming under the differential diagnosis of renal tumor with papillary architecture, that is type 2 PRCC. Hereditary leiomyomatosis and renal cell carcinoma associated RCC showing prominent nucleoli. XP11 translocation carcinoma showing seminal bodies and 6-11 translocation carcinoma showing a biphasic pattern of cells with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm and clusters of small cells with hyperchromatic nuclei and scant eosinophilic cytoplasm. Now the collecting duct carcinoma. This tumor arises from the principal cells of renal collecting duct of Bellini. The tumor is located in the deep medulla, and macroscopically they present as firm white cut surface with areas of hemorrhagic necrosis. Lymph node metastasis is quite common in this tumor, and the tumor usually present at higher stage. The tumor show tubular or tubulopapillary architecture, irregular elongated branching tubule lined by single layer of epithelial cells are seen. The cells are cuboidal, columnar, and some hobnail cells are also seen. Nuclei are large, vesicular, with prominent nucleoli. Abundant mitosis, including the atypical mitotic figure, are also evident. And the sarcomatoid and the rhabdoid transformation is quite common in this tumor. CK7 and high molecular weight keratin stain are positive in collecting the carcinoma. Finally, we'll tell a few words regarding a benign tumor that also shows papillary architecture, that is metanephric adenoma. This tumor needs to be distinguished from the malignant epithelial tumor because it has a completely benign pores. And this tumor gives a positive BRAF V600E reaction when IC study is done. Now, renal cell tumor with oncocytic cytoplasm. The renal oncocytic neoplasm usually originate from the intercalated cells and hence demonstrate CD117 positivity. A morphological assessment is often most helpful to distinguish the two primary entities in this category, that is oncocytoma and tumor for renal cell carcinoma. Along with positive CD117 expression, tumor for renal cell carcinoma usually express diffuse and uniform CK7, which is not seen in case of oncocytoma, which affects positivity. We'll discuss it in the next slides. Now, first, we'll discuss oncocytoma, which is a benign epithelial renal neoplasm. This tumor usually arises in 6th to 7th decade. The tumor shows abundant, the classic macroscopic appearance of the oncocytoma is a mahogany brown tumor with well demarcated margin and a central stellate scar. Microscopically, this tumor shows abundant densely eosinophilic cytoplasm with uniform round nuclei. Degenerative change may appear in oncocytoma, but in contrast to tumor for renal cell carcinoma nuclei, they are not resinoid. The tumor for renal cell carcinoma nuclei are resinoid, but degenerated oncocytoma nuclei are not resinoid, rather they are smudgy and hyperchromatic. Mitosis is usually absent in oncocytoma. This is oncocytoma, degenerative change showing smudgy hyperchromatic nuclei, and cytokeratin 7 show patchy positivity, or rather it may be negative also. And in this picture, we are showing a biopsy of oncocytic renal nuclei. Sometimes it may not be possible to diagnose or to differentiate between the oncocytoma and tumor for renal cell carcinoma on needle biopsy specimen because of the scanty tissue or paucity of the tissue. In that case, what should you do? For needle core biopsy specimen that have been morphologic, that have a morphologic and immunophenotypic finding of oncocytoma, interpret them as oncocytic renal cell neoplasm and give the following comment. If this biopsy is representative of entire lesion, it would be consistent with an oncocytoma. However, renal cell carcinoma and hybrid tumor may uncommonly show focal areas with oncocytic features. Now, tumor for renal cell carcinoma. Tumor for renal cell carcinoma is a low-grade renal malignancy. They have more favorable prognosis and they usually present at a lower stage. As Farman nuclear grading does not correspond to the prognosis in the tumor for renal cell carcinoma, some uropathologists do not recommend their use in this tumor. The tumor for renal cell carcinoma usually show a solid growth pattern. The cells show abundant cytoplasm with prominent cell border. The nuclei are irregular with wrinkled border. In contrast to oncocytoma, the myxoid or hyalinized background is lacking. And this tumor gives a positive pulse colloidal iron stain. It is positive blue. CK7 is diffusely positive in tumor for renal cell carcinoma in contrast to tacky positivity in oncocytoma. Now, hybrid tumor. This terminology refers to a specific tumor type that combines the morphologic and immunohistochemical feature of both oncocytoma and tumor for renal cell carcinoma. Although these tumors may be sporadic, many are seen in patients with Bart-Hoglund syndrome. This syndrome can manifest with multifocal oncocytomas and tumor for renal cell carcinoma and should be suggested by a pathologist when more than one lesion is present unilaterally or bilaterally. Fibrofolliculoma is a typical skin finding in patients with Bart-Hoglund syndrome. The clinical behavior of this tumor is less aggressive than the sporadic carcinoma. This is tumor for renal cell carcinoma with microtubular architecture. This is resinoid nuclei. Now, tubulocystic carcinoma. This is tubulocystic carcinoma. The tubulocystic carcinoma is a rarer variant of carcinoma which shows striking male predominance. It presents in older people and prognosis is very good. Microscopically, they show tightly packed tubules and cysts separated by thin fibrovascular septum. The cells are cuboidal to columnar with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm. Large nuclei and prominent nuclei. Use of Farman grading in this tumor is also controversial. Now, acquired cystic disease, cystic kidney disease associated RCC. They develop in end-stage renal diseases. Microscopically, they show solid fibriform or microcystic pattern. This tumor is, our tumors are composed of large cells with abundant deep eosinophilic cytoplasm, large nuclei with prominent nucleoli. Intratumoral oxalate crystal is very characteristic finding in this tumor. They are positive for CD10 and resmis, and CK7 is negative. Now, another new entity that is follicular thyroid-like carcinoma. This is the least frequent and least studied variant of RCC. The tumor has no relationship with the thyroid carcinoma, and the nomenclature stems purely from the light microscopic appearance. Morphologically, this carcinoma has a thick fibrous capsule and composed of microfollicular and macrofollicular structures with light pink or dense red colloid-like secretions. The follicles are lined by low cuboidal cells. TTF1 is negative in this tumor, and some cases has been reported to be immunoreactive to CK7, CG10, and PAX2. This is cystic kidney disease associated RCC, showing oxalate crystal. This is called atypical cyst. This is supposed to be a precursor lesion of this entity. This follicular thyroid-like carcinoma, showing microfollicular structures with colloid-like material. Now, classical clear cell renal cell carcinoma can also show eosinophilic cell morphology. The eosinophilic CCRCC grossly often has extensive hemorrhage and necrosis. Microscopically, it usually has an estate pattern of growth surrounded by sinusoidal vasculature, as in case of classical one. Wide spectrum of immunohistochemical stains are available to discriminate this entity from others. Now, RCC with rhabdoid features. As I mentioned, this tumor is not a distinct type of carcinoma, but rather an extremely differentiated form of any sort of RCC or any type of RCC. The term rhabdoid designates from high-grade tumor cells with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm and peripherally located nuclei, thus resembling rhabdomyoblast. This tumor is not related to the pediatric rhabdoid tumor, and INI1 is not lost in this tumor. Now, a new entity, that is eosinophilic solid and cystic renal cell carcinoma, is morphologically, clinically, and immunohistochemically distinct tumor. Characteristic eosinophilic cells with voluminous cytoplasm comprising solid and cystic area, this eosinophilic solid and cystic RCC, are seen. This tumor stain positive for CK10, and this is CD117 negative. Somatic mutation involving the tubular sclerosis gene 1 and 2 has been noted in this tumor. Now, epithelioid angiomyolipoma, this may be misdiagnosed as unclassified high-grade carcinoma, but the age of presentation is little earlier. Tuberous sclerosis patients are more prone to develop this epithelioid angiomyolipoma. Two types of tumor cells are seen in this tumor, that is clear cell with granular cytoplasm and small monomorphic nuclei, and eosinophilic cell with abundant cytoplasm. Epithelioid morphology and the large nuclei, prominent nucleoli are seen. These cells are also known as amoeboid cells. Amoeboid cells. Epithelioid angiomyolipoma may behave as in a malignant fashion. The risk for malignancy are seen if at least three of the following characteristic features are present, that is 70% of the atypical epithelioid cells, at least two mitoses for 10 high power field, presence of atypical mitosis and necrosis. This tumor is PAX8 negative in contrast to the carcinoma, and HMP45 and melanin is positive. So, the summary is, we have described common renal neoplasms with eosinophilic cytoplasm, although many of those tumors have overlapping findings, recognition of key morphological features, and selection of correct ancillary tests usually allow for a correct classification.